Well, we certainly had a Cole Custer victory come out of frickin' nowhere in this race. And it was a damn good finish. But a good finish does not a good race make. This race was fucking trash. Let's get into it. This is The Fuel. What's happening, ladies and germs? This is the Packer Man, and welcome to today's edition of The Fuel, where today we are going to be talking about and reviewing the 2020 Quaker State 400 at Kentucky Speedway. And, of course, as per the usual, it sucked some major dick. Except for a few parts. I mean, of course, you see the name of this episode is called Shit Sandwich. Let me explain why I called it that. Basically, in my opinion, the first 40 laps of this race were pretty good. And then, of course, there was the finish, which we're going to talk about at the end of this review. But in between all that, nothing but a gigantic steaming pile of monkey shit. That's what I think of this race. So, yeah, the Kentucky Speedway has always sucked ass. I mean, I think literally 2015 was the only time we ever saw a good race, or a somewhat decent race at Kentucky, but other than that, the racing there just fucking sucks. And today was certainly no exception. Sends a couple of spots during this race, but I mean, beginning and the end were good. Everything in between was crap. But that's not really the main talking point, other than maybe the winner of this race. But before we get into all of that, there is so much shit to go through. Can't believe how many news stories we have to talk about this week. It's a loaded episode, to say the least. With our news of the week. But before we get into all that, I made this promise last week that I would tear Goodyear apart. So before we get into the news of the week, here is today's Dumbass of the Week. And obviously, this week's Dumbass of the Week is Goodyear. As we remember a week ago at the Brickyard, there were a lot of right front tire failures. And in response to all of that, Goodyear had this to say. They released a statement regarding all the right front tire failures at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway last week. So, this is what they had to say. The importance of air pressure and getting it right is something that we cautioned about before the race. With the high amount of downforce on the cup cars down the straightaways, we asked teams to respect our recommended pressures so as not to hurt the tire. Early in the race, without having the benefit of any practice, teams obviously had to be very mindful of that. Most of the race was run in the heat, and teams were obviously searching for grip, while several issues happened later in the event when track temperature cooled off a bit and speeds picked up. We had our engineers on the ground all race, working with teams as we do every week, trying to emphasize the importance of right front pressures. In other words, they're not accepting responsibility for any of the tire failures that happened at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. They're blaming it all on the teams for not adhering to the recommended tire pressures. Yeah, that kind of bullshit excuse would be viable if it weren't for the fact that there were multiple teams that suffered tire failures. If it was all confined to one team, that'd be one thing. Like, if it was just Joe Gibbs Racing cars that had right front tire failures, then that'd be one thing. But we had them from Roush, from Joe Gibbs, from Hendrick. There were quite a few different teams that had tire failures, so I'm not buying that, you know, stupid bullshit excuse from Goodyear. But then again, what else would you expect from them at this point? They never want to take responsibility for their fucking tire failures. They're piece of fucking trash tires. And this is not the first time that they've had, you know, a tire, you know, schmozzle at Indianapolis. Remember 2008? Remember that fucking race? When they had to throw competition cautions every 10 fucking laps because Goodyear's tires were fucking trash? And we've seen this time and time again from Goodyear, whether it be from their tire wars with Firestone or with Hoosier. Their tires are fucking garbage. You know, at least in the IndyCar series and, you know, in Formula One, Pirelli and Firestone seem to have their fucking act together. Can't really say a whole lot about Goodyear, though, can you? I don't know, maybe it's time for NASCAR to start shopping around for a different tire supplier, because Goodyear's fucking trash. Lord knows I wouldn't use any of those fucking tires on my car. I don't think I have, to be honest. I have a different manufacturer tire. I would get Firestones, but they're pretty fucking expensive, to say the least, but... Yeah, I wouldn't trust Goodyear with my life on those fucking tires. I really wouldn't. They're fucking garbage. And as far as I'm concerned, NASCAR needs to be looking for a different tire supplier. But that's just my opinion. So that is your dumbass of the week. Probably won't be the last time Goodyear gets that honor. I'll tell you that much. But now that I've gotten that out of the way... Saddle up, because we have a very, very loaded news of the week section this week. So let's get into it. All right. So starting things out with the news of the week, let's go ahead and talk about the Rev Group Grand Prix races at Road America for the IndyCar series this week. So as far as the first race is concerned, Scott Dixon won, so he basically started the season with three straight wins, which is kind of crazy, but also kind of like, how about we have a different winner? From what I heard, the race was okay. I didn't really get a chance to watch it. Didn't really get a chance to watch the second race either, I mean, other than a few highlights here and there, but the results from race number one. Scott Dixon with the win, led 16 laps. Will Power came home in second. Alex Palou, the rookie, driving car number 55, came home in third position, his first career podium. Then you had Ryan Hunter-Reay, Colton Herta, Santino Ferrucci, Graham Rahal, Pato O'Ward, and this would not be his best performance of the week. Takuma Sato and Marcus Ericsson rounded out the top 10 for race number one. But then in race two, from what I saw, was a pretty banger of a race and a pretty banger of a finish too. When you had Pato O'Ward, he led a large majority of the laps, 43 of the 55 laps. But late in the race, Felix Rosenqvist ran him down from behind and had a great battle with Pato O'Ward for the lead with two laps to go, and would actually pass O'Ward for the lead. And he only led eight laps on the day, but he led the last two that were the most important. And Felix Rosenqvist finally gets his first career win. And of course, it was a battle between two guys who were looking for their first career wins. Rosenqvist and Pato O'Ward, who drives for Arrow McLaren, I believe is the name of the team. Schmidt-Peterson Arrow McLaren, I think is the name. But Rosenqvist with his first career win. This means that Ganassi has won the first four races of the year. Pato O'Ward with his first career podium. Alexander Rossi comes home in third. Marcus Ericsson in fourth. Colton Herta with another fifth place finish. Santino Ferrucci with another sixth place finish. Alex Palou in seventh. Then you have Takuma Sato, Joseph Newgarden, and Charlie Kimball in the top 10. Which leads to the point standings after four of 14 races. Scott Dixon actually ended up 12th in the second Road America race, but it doesn't really matter because he has 173 points right now, which is 54 more than Colton Herta, who's in second place. So just four races in and Scott Dixon already has a full race advantage in a 14 race season. So he is well on his way to championship number six. Then you have Simon Pagenaud in third, and then Pato O'Ward in fourth. Really moved up after a pretty good weekend. Joseph Newgarden in fifth, your defending champion. And Marcus Ericsson in the third Chip Ganassi car is currently sixth in the championship with 93 points. So pretty good run for him so far this season. So let's head back to the Brickyard for a quick second because... total viewership on NBC for the Brickyard 400 was up 46% versus 2019. So the average total audience delivery on NBC was 4.37 million, which is the most watched Brickyard 400 since 2017. Across the board, gains of at least 40% versus last year's Brickyard 400 in viewership, household rating, and streaming. TV audience peaked at more than 5 million viewers for what they said was the thrilling conclusion of the race, which I don't know what they were smoking there. But the NBC Sports NASCAR IndyCar crossover weekend coverage set viewership milestones across all three races. And there were a lot of people on social media that were trying to make excuses like, well, it was the only race on, you know, and all this other bullshit. And it's like, dude, shut the fuck up, okay? How about you stop coming up with excuses, you know, and trying to downplay, you know, what NASCAR has been able to do because you don't like the product. I mean, if you hate it that much, stop trying to fucking watch it and stop tweeting about it on fucking social media. Because nobody's going to give a fuck about what you say. It gets really fucking tiresome. You know, because the only thing it makes you look like is just a salty bitch is really all it looks like to you. I mean, if you don't like it that much, hey, nobody's forcing you to watch it. I mean, what else am I supposed to say about that? But yeah, quite the increase, which is kind of surprising to me. I mean, the Brickyard 400 this year was slightly better, I guess, than last year's, but you know, it's whatever. But one guy who was not at the Brickyard, unfortunately, was Jimmy Johnson. And he may have been the victim of a false positive of COVID-19 because it was reported earlier this week that NASCAR confirmed that Jimmy Johnson was cleared the race. He tested negative for COVID-19 on Monday and Tuesday, and he was cleared by his physician Tuesday night, according to Hendrick Motorsports. Four Hendrick Motorsports crew members were tested for COVID-19, with all four receiving negative results. So basically, he may have had to miss the Brickyard 400, which would have been his last, for a false positive. Because I find it kind of weird that he showed no symptoms whatsoever, yet he had, you know, a positive test. I mean, his wife had symptoms of it. So, I mean, it was easy, you know, to assume that he might have contracted it as well. But when you don't have any symptoms whatsoever and you test positive for it, and then you have two negative tests in a row following said positive test, really does make you wonder if it was a false positive, which really kind of sucks. But speaking of COVID-19, NASCAR sent a memo to teams about COVID-19, and here's what this memo said. There are pockets of complacency that, left unchecked, will threaten our ability to continue racing. We're seeing more and more vanloads of crew members rolling up to the track without masks on, and people wearing their mask down to their chin. Down around their chin, I should say. Only two of five pit crew members answered honestly on their pre-entry questionnaire. about their prolonged exposure to a colleague who tested positive. With infection rates significantly increasing in many places we work and race, including Florida, North Carolina, and Texas, exposure to community spread is increased. More people in our industry are going to contract the virus. The key is limiting it. Maintaining the integrity of the footprint in the garage area with only essential personnel being allowed is imperative. It is important for everyone to do their part all the time. One cluster outbreak can derail our season. Please ensure this is communicated properly throughout your organizations. And in that case, I really don't blame them, because, I mean, remember what happened earlier this year when NASCAR basically had to shut down for 2.5 months because of this shit? You know, they're trying to not have a repeat of this so we can get through this season, this crazy mashed together season, and try to get through to next year. And of course, there are some things about this current season that we're going to be talking about here in a little bit. But then some more shit surrounding Bubba Wallace. And what the President of the United States, Donald Trump, said, which, you know, I'm kind of indifferent on Trump, but, I mean, you know, this is whatever. He tweeted out, "Has Bubba Wallace apologized to all those great NASCAR drivers and officials who came to his aid, stood by his side, and were willing to sacrifice everything for him? Only to find out that the whole thing was just another hoax. That and flag decision has caused lowest ratings ever." First thing, that whole thing was not Bubba's fault. NASCAR was the one who reported to him what was said, or what was found in that garage area. And secondly, the decision to axe the Confederate flag has not dipped ratings at all. In fact, they're seeing a market increase in viewership this year. And you can make all the excuses that you want. The bottom line is more people are watching NASCAR this year than they were last year and the year before. So that's an inaccurate statement. And as a result of said inaccurate statement, NASCAR had a reaction to the tweet that said, "We are proud to have Bubba Wallace in the NASCAR family, and we commend his courage and leadership. NASCAR continues to stand tall with Bubba, our competitors, and everyone who makes our sport welcoming and inclusive for all racing fans." And Tyler Reddick had also expressed his support with Bubba and basically tweeted out to Trump that he said, "We don't really need your support." On SiriusXM NASCAR, Reddick speaks about his tweet, which he deleted. He said, "I stand by my comments on Twitter, and I support my friend, and my support for my friend Bubba Wallace." Says he responded emotionally, and after many conversations with the men and women at RCR, the decision was made to delete the post. In other words, Richard Childress made him delete the post, which I think is pretty fucking stupid. So it's pretty obvious where RCR stands on that, which I don't agree with whatsoever. And on that note, NASCAR has also been in talks to ban certain political paint schemes, considering that, you know, because some teams have been are being sponsored by certain politicians and shit like that. And NASCAR has been considering banning political paint schemes. You know, it's really whatever if they do or not. I mean, that's their decision. I really don't have any feelings on that one way or the other. Let's see. Did that. See, there's so much stuff to talk about. I have to make sure I know which ones I've done. Okay, so there's a couple more left. But let's move on to some sad news that happened this weekend. This is not technically NASCAR related news, But it still sucks big time when a race car driver loses his life in a racing accident. This past Saturday night at Larry King Law's Langley Speedway, as it's now called, they released an official statement regarding the passing of one of the best drivers that they've ever had, Sean Beluso, who died on Saturday night in a crash in the feature event. They released a statement saying, "Our hearts are heavy this morning. Driver Sean Beluso passed away following an incident during Saturday night's modified feature at Langley Speedway, leaving behind a championship legacy both on and off the track. He won the hearts of our fans with 11 track championships and a driving style that made him one of the most respected competitors we've ever known. The Langley Speedway family grieves at this terrible loss and offers our deepest condolences to his wife Terry and his three children. We ask that you respect the family's privacy during this trying time." And from what I've heard, he was definitely, I guess you could say, a local legend at Langley Speedway. I mean, 11 track championships, that's pretty damn impressive. And apparently last year, he had won 15 features in a row. Damn. I mean, that's impressive. So, I would say I never heard of him before this whole thing happened, but be that as it may, it still sucks when a racing driver loses their life like that, especially one who was as well respected at Langley Speedway as Sean Beluso was. I mean, 11 track championships? I mean, so, certainly my condolences to the Beluso family. I mean, as a race fan, this is something you never want to see. I mean, we love high speed and danger and, you know, high competition and all that good stuff. But as a race fan, this is the last thing you want to see. You don't want to see a competitor lose their life in a crash like this. So, definitely a sad day in motorsports on Saturday night and this weekend, to be honest. So, and Mike Joy said as much during the broadcast as well. So, may Sean Beluso rest in peace. In a news story that was a bit of a shocker, NASCAR decided that for this year's All-Star Race at Bristol, they are going to install underglow lights on the race cars that are going to be racing in the All-Star Race. Yes, the same underglow lights that they used at burnout exhibitions, you know, during like Champions Week, where they installed like underglow lights on the cars, and you could see like the different colors like shine underneath the cars, which I thought were pretty cool. Well, they're going to be using them for the All-Star Race during the race. I think that's going to look pretty badass, and it's certainly going to be an interesting little experiment to see if they're going to do that for future All-Star races or any other special events for that matter. I like it. I think it'd be pretty cool to see, especially during a race time. I think it'll be interesting to see what'll happen there. So that's a cool little deal. But of course, one of the big news stories coming out of this week, Watkins Glen. Now, I reported last week that there were concerns that Watkins Glen was not going to be able to run because New York was not going to grant them a quarantine waiver for the race. Well, NASCAR has gone ahead and made the decision to move the Watkins Glen race to a new racetrack. They're going to be going to Daytona, but they're not racing on the oval. They're saving that for the regular season finale. They're racing on the road course. The same road course that we see in the Rolex 24 sports car race. Now, NASCAR was going to run on the Daytona infield road course for the Clash next year, but looks like we're going to get a sneak preview. And I remember Slap Shoes made a suggestion to have the second Daytona points race be on the road course. Well, we're going to get that experiment right now, or at least in August, because that was when Watkins Glen was going to happen. And so we're going to have two more Daytona races, one on the road course and then the 400 miler. And they're going to be sandwiched right between two doubleheaders, which I expected was going to happen. Michigan's going to run both of their races back to back, and then Dover's going to run both of their races back to back. And of course, because of the fact that it is going to be a doubleheader, both races for Michigan and for Dover have been shortened to 500 kilometers, or 311 miles. So both races will be 500K races when we get to those in August. And that is your news of the week. Didn't take as long as I thought it would. But still a lot of news stories to go through. But with all that out of the way, let's get into the review for the Quaker State 400. All right, here we go. 2020 Quaker State 400 at Kentucky. So, stages broke down like this. Stages 1 and 2, 80 laps. Stage 3, 107 laps, with the halfway point being 134. Didn't really have to deal with weather. I mean, there were some sprinkles that came down late in the race, but they weren't really a factor. It was just a light sprinkle. But finally, no weather delays this time. How about that? Too bad the race wasn't better. But Kyle Busch drew the pole for this race. I tell you, he has not been looking good this year at all. No stage wins, no wins at all. He has zero playoff points right now. And we're about to hit the halfway point of the season. I mean, if you had told me that when we get to the halfway point, Kyle Busch would have zero wins and zero stage wins, I would have asked you what you were smoking. Unreal. But here we go. Kyle Busch leads lap one. Almirola and Keselowski get by Logano for second and third. Harvick looked very loose at the start of the race. Almirola starts challenging Kyle Busch for the race lead. Keselowski and Logano start battling for third. And then Almirola with a great pass on Kyle Busch into turn three for the lead. And oh my god, we had a pure lead change! Sound effects machine. That was the clapping noise. Because we finally had a pure lead change! We hadn't had one since the first Pocono race a couple weeks ago. The second Pocono race and the Brickyard 400 had zero pure lead changes. Like, what the fuck? But at the very least, we had our first pure lead change of the day. Thankfully, it would not be the only one. There weren't that many, but, you know, at the very least, we had fucking pure lead change for once. It happened on lap 10. Logano gets Kez loose in turn 2 to take over the third position, with Alex Bowman taking fourth. Truex had to start the rear of the field due to inspection issues, but was coming through the field and was a factor at the end of this race. Lots of loose cars in the field at the moment, and they were probably glad when the competition caution came out on lap 26. Everyone comes in for service. Now Barolo wins the race off pit road, so he leads on the restart. Elliott moves up to second as they go four wide in the pack. Battle for fourth between Harvick and Blaney. Then Blaney's car jumped out of gear and turns 1 and 2 once, recovers, and gets by Harvick for the 5th position. Basically, Blaney had to basically one-hand it through the turns, at least through turns 1 and 2. And he had to hold the shifter in place because he couldn't really get a... Because typically they would have a bungee cord in place for that just in case it started popping out of gear. So instead he had to hold the shifter in place, and they actually had a camera in the car where you could actually see inside, and it was vibrating like all hell. Like, you know how you shake your fist, like you're trying to not punch somebody. You want to punch somebody, but, you know, you're just trying to hold back and your hand is like shaking. It was like that, except it was like at hyper speed. And every lap you could see him like shaking his hand, because I imagine that didn't feel very good. And he had to do that for 3 hours, basically. Unreal. Matty D moves up to third by Logano, but has to check up after Jonathan Nemechek nearly loses it in turn one, which allows Logano to get back by. And Eric Almirola wins stage number one. Eric Almirola actually looked really good in the early portion of this race. He actually led more than half of this race. Well, actually, almost half of this race. He led 128 laps. But second half, he wasn't really a factor, which is surprising. First half of stage one was good, like I said. First 40 laps were pretty good. After that, it was just, downhill from there. Everyone comes in for service, and Almirola wins the stage off pit road. Like I said, he had a really good car early on. So he leads the start of stage two. We have a battle for fourth between Elliott, Blaney, and Bowman, which was actually pretty good for a couple laps. And at this point, I was like, man, Almirola's looking really good right now. And he did look good early on. Harvick was really struggling at the moment. He was back around 20th on lap 105, which was really surprising. But then he would turn around and be a factor at the end of this race. Truex up to 6th after having to start last. Blaney gets by Logano for 2nd and then chases down Almirola and takes the lead, one-handing it all the way for a 2nd pure lead change on lap 138. Logano moves up to 2nd by Almirola. It was pretty obvious at this point that it looked like Almirola had worn out his front tires, in particular the left front. Reddick kicks off green flag stops on lap 144. Blaney pits from the lead on lap 150, and then right before the pit stop cycle completes, we get our second caution on lap 155 when Matt Kenseth spins in turn 3 after apparently losing a tire. He had just made a pit stop, but a possibility was that the valve stem got knocked out of one of his tires and basically lost air rapidly and it went flat on him. And Keselowski was a huge beneficiary of this, because I think he was running like 15th before the pit stop cycle started, and he was on pit road when the caution came out. And then when his pit stop was completed, I got down, and since he crossed the start, he was behind the start finish line, his pit stall was, and when the caution came out, all he had to do was move a little bit across the start finish line, and since he got to there before anyone else did, he got to come out as the leader of the race, basically, because the field is frozen at that point. So huge break for Keselowski. So we have a one lap shootout to end stage two, which Keselowski leads. And Blaney had a run coming off of turn four, but Keselowski would hold Blaney at bay to win stage number two. So he basically got a free playoff point right there. Just extremely lucky. But this race was really sucking ass at this point. I mean, you noticed that there wasn't really that much in the way of notes. I had 1.5 pages of notes. Well, not even a half, page and a half of notes for the first two stages. That's how boring it fucking was. Once everything got spread out, there was literally nothing happening in the middle of this race. It was that bad. We have stage three, 107 laps. Keselowski leads the start of stage three. Truex and Blaney battles hard for the second position with Jimmy Johnson right behind as they fan out to the field. Kyle Busch almost lost it off of turn four, but somehow saves it. I believe if it was anyone else, it would have been wrecked. He did get into the wall a little bit with the right rear, but all things considered, he's lucky he still had a whole race car. Truex starts challenging Kez for the lead. Blaney and Johnson start battling for third, and Truex gets by Keselowski for the race lead for a third pure lead change on lap 182. Jimmy Johnson pits with 59 laps to go due to a vibration, but he is in the window to make it the rest of the way. So he basically kicked off the final round of pit stops, or at least what should have been the final round of pit stops. Battle for ninth between Almirola, Buescher, and Custer, which was pretty good. Truex pits from the lead on lap 47, or with 47 laps to go. There were several cars that were staying out, and then we had our third caution on lap 229. When Brennan Poole loses a left rear tire and leaves debris on the track, which was why the caution was thrown. Austin Dillon was getting ready to come to pit road, but then the caution came out and closed pit road. So he had to try to get back out onto the racetrack and ended up spinning himself out. That was a fail. Top six had not pitted yet and come in for service. Truex stays out and leads on the restart with 30 laps to go. And this is when the cautions really started flying. Harvick gets by Kez for fourth. Johnson gets by Kez for fifth. Johnson up to third after restarting ninth. He had fresh tires. Things getting heated at the last run of this race. And then we had our fourth caution on lap 244 when John Hrnček smacked the wall in turn two. Truex led on the restart with 19 laps to go, but then we get our fifth caution right away on lap 249. Keselowski had a run on Jimmy Johnson coming to the tri-oval. Basically had to go down to the apron to get around him because he had a run. Johnson looked like he tried to block but came across Keselowski's bumper and ended up spinning himself out. Couldn't really tell at first, so I thought Kez had dumped Johnson, but as it turned out, Johnson kind of came across Keselowski's nose to try to block the run that Keselowski had. So, racing incident there. And Blaney was ahead of Truex when the caution came out. So, he was ahead at the scoring loop. A couple sprinkles reported on the spotter stands, as I noted earlier, but no issue. Blaney leads on the restart with 13 laps to go. Harvick takes it three wide with Blaney and Truex to take over the race lead. And at that point, I was just like, oh, God. Are we seriously going to have Harvick win yet another fucking race? Lord have mercy. All that just to go back to the status quo. That's what it looked like at first. Truex started closing back in on Harvick and starts challenging him for the lead, but once again, before he could complete the move, our sixth caution came in on lap 260 when Matt Kenseth gets spun out by Ryan Newman off of turn four. Now, I wrote down that they were getting ready for the first GWC, but it turns out they didn't actually get that far. It was actually two laps to go in regulation, so it was actually lap 266 when Harvick got the restart. And that's when shit really started getting crazy, because, let's see, how did this go down? So, Harvick got a great run, obviously on the outside, because he chose the outside for the restart, So Truex is kind of in the middle of three wide because Cole Custer had actually managed to get a run on the very, very outside, and he had Blaney on the inside and Truex in the middle. But Truex managed to get clear, clipped Harvick a little bit down the back stretch, which sent Harvick to the inside a little bit, which allowed Truex to get around on the outside and get the outside run in turns three and four. And I'm thinking, oh, Truex has got a great shot here. And then coming off of turn four, Blaney ducks all the way to the inside, so all of a sudden we're three wide. And then, coming to the white flag, Cole Custer goes to the very, very top and makes it four wide for the lead. And I'm thinking, oh, fuck. They're going four wide in turn one. This may not end well. And Blaney was all the way down on the apron, and apparently he hit a bump, which caused him to shoot up into Harvick, and I thought, oh, shit! Somehow they kept it straight. Harvick had a tire rub from the contact, and Cole Custer managed to get clear of everybody to take over the race lead, and he held on. He held off Truex through turns three and four, and Cole Custer, someone who had not really run all that well this year, let's be honest here, because he, even with this win, he's currently 20. He's still 20th in the point standings, technically. But with this win, his first career win, I might add, he becomes the first rookie, first full-time rookie, to win in a long time. You know, I had a feeling that, you know, one of these rookies was going to win sometime this year, whether it be Reddick or Bell. Or John, even maybe even John Hrnček at one point, or Cole Custer, because they all have the talent to do it. But this one kind of came out of nowhere for Custer, because I mean he did finish top five at the Brickyard 400, so it's like maybe they're starting to put together. This one kind of came out of nowhere, because let's be honest here, he wasn't really a super factor for the lead this entire race. He only led five laps, and he led the one that mattered, and it was a last lap pass. So we actually had our fourth pure lead change at the checkered flag. A last lap pass for the win. So, Custer gets the win. Truex finishes second. Matt DiBenedetto manages to sneak through all the riffraff and comes home with a third place finish. So that solidifies his position in the points. And I even said Cole Custer becomes the first rookie to win this year, and he also becomes the first rookie to win at Kentucky. What? Kentucky has been a very tough track to win at in the Cup Series. Fun fact, all the previous winners of Kentucky in the nine races that we've had, Cup races at Kentucky, all former Cup champions. So that just goes to show you the pedigree, which means that Cole Custer is probably going to be a future Cup champion at one point, I'd say. But he certainly got the talent to do it, I think. I mean, this year, he didn't start out that well, but I think he's starting to find his groove, because, he finished top five at the Brickyard 400 last week, and then comes out of nowhere and steals this win away, his first career win. It's just unbelievable. And we all thought that, Custer, he definitely had the pedigree, I think, to be a contender. And he notches his first career win in his rookie season. So the pressure's on for Reddick and Bell now to try to get a win this year. I was like, well, that was unexpected. Certainly didn't expect a finish like that. And boy, and you know what this does? This completely blows up the playoff picture, because Custer is 20th in points right now, but his win puts him into the playoff. Because there's not going to be more than 16 winners. As long as he maintains a top 30 spot in the point standings, he's in the playoff, regardless of where he is. He's 20th in points, and he's going to be competing for a championship. And, while I'm happy for the 41 team that they're going to get that opportunity, it just showcases how bad this playoff system is. But I'm not going to downplay Cole Custer getting that win. I mean, he was in the right place at the right time, but that was a ballsy fucking move to go four wide on the outside like that. And you know what? It paid off big time. I mean, that's how you want to get your first career win, is a move like that. So like I've always said, you never forget your first time. In fact, we had a whole plethora of first time winners, it felt like. I think Sheldon Creed got his first career truck win, even though it was rain shortened. And then you have Felix Rosenquist get his first career win in IndyCar at Road America. And now you have Cole Custer getting his first Cup win here at Kentucky. So, good job by that 41 team. Pretty sure they've been waiting for a bit to finally get back to victory lane, and they get the job done. That's really all you could say. So, let's go ahead and get to the race results and the point standings and call it a day. All right, before we get to the results, lead change count, as we usually do here. There were 13 overall lead changes in this race. Not really a whole hell of a lot, but we did have four pure lead changes this week, which again, not a whole lot, but it was more than the last two races. In fact, the last three races combined. The last three races we had a grand total of two pure lead changes, and those were in the first Pocono race. The second Pocono race and Indy had zero. So, and this one, ended with a last lap pass, so there was that. But that out of the way, let's take a look at your top 10 results for the Quaker State 400. Cole Custer started 29th, ended up in victory lane after leading just five laps. Martin Truex Jr., it says he started 9th, but he had to go to the rear of the field due to inspection issues. before the race, but would end up finishing in second, which is a great run for him. Led 57 laps. Matt DiBenedetto in third. Kevin Harvick in fourth. Kurt Busch comes home in the fifth position. And then you have Ryan Blaney, who I think led at the white flag, but thanks to his contact with Kevin Harvick, ended up sixth. Christopher Bell comes home in seventh. Eric Almirola led the most laps, 128 laps in total, but ends up in eighth position after losing his track position. And you have Brad Keselowski and Tyler Reddick rounding out the top 10. So all three of our big rookies, Cole Custer, Christopher Bell, and Tyler Reddick, all ended up in the top 10 at the finish of this race. That's pretty crazy. So, point standings after 17 races, one away from the halfway point. Obviously, Kevin Harvick continues to lead the way, has a pretty significant points lead, and is on his way to becoming the regular season champion. And you have Brad Keselowski in second now, despite just six top fives and two wins. He has two wins, though, so, and 12 top tens, so he's been doing pretty good. But that's still a ways behind Harvick. Ryan Blaney in third. Chase Elliott in fourth, 100 points behind Harvick. Joey Logano fifth. Denny Hamlin moves up to sixth. And you have Martin Truex Jr. Eric Almirola is the first non-winner in eighth position. Then you have Alex Bowman and Kurt Busch in the top 10. Then you have Kyle Busch in 11th. Again, no stage wins, no wins at all this year so far. Matt DiBenedetto in 12th. Then you have Clint Bowyer, William Byron, Jimmy Johnson, and Austin Dillon in the top 16. However, with Cole Custer winning, that means that Austin Dillon is kind of boned at this point, because he's number 16, but he doesn't have a win. Cole Custer does. Tyler Reddick is in 17th, Eric Jones, and then Bubba Wallace in 19th, and then Cole Custer, despite the fact that he is 67 points behind Austin Dillon for the 16th spot, because he has that win at Kentucky in his pocket, he is now in the playoff. So basically the cutoff point now is 15th, which is where Jimmy Johnson is at this point in time, despite having one fewer start than everybody else because he had to miss the Brickyard 400. And by the way, he is still eligible to go for the championship because he does have a medical waiver. So there's that. As for my final rating for the Quaker State 400, I mean, it was not good at all. This was basically, you know, two runs at the beginning and the end that were good, sandwiched, and then you had a giant pile of shit sandwiched in between like a sandwich, you know, like a Subway sub. I mean, this race was just not that good. It was not, you know, and a lot of people are going to say it's a good finish in Jeff Gluck's poll, but you can't base how good a race is on how good the finish is, and vice versa. You got to take the whole thing as a package deal, and let's be completely honest here. 80% of this race was fucking trash. I mean, the finish was great, and I would say the first 40 laps were pretty good, watchable, good competition. But other than that, what else was there to talk about in this race? Literally almost nothing happened, except at the beginning and the end. So, my final rating for the Quaker State 400, I'll give it a 3.5 out of 10. Now, like I said, a lot of this race was fucking trash. The beginning and the end was the only thing that were good. That was good about this race, and that's pretty much it. So, that's going to do it. Next week, we're going to have two episodes of The Fuel, as my mother decides to call me. But anyway, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next week here on The Fuel. So then, take it easy. You better like and subscribe or face the consequences. You have been warned.